up as we go along. And there's a little short film at the end which helps explain some of the things that go on. So I hope you'll get a good impression by the end of the whole story. It seems to me that popular Western culture doesn't think much of capitalists and entrepreneurs today. If you go to an average movie, for instance, the hero is often someone quite different. The scientists and capitalists are the enemies. Being an entrepreneur is a great thing, a creative thing, and an exciting thing. And to make profits is the only way the world will grow and be a better place for people to live. Johan Norberg, a Swedish writer, said that entrepreneurs should never be grateful for a society which gives them license to act, dream, innovate, and create. He said, "I think that we, society, should be grateful to the entrepreneur and to the businessman for what they do. Entrepreneurs are the heroes of our world. Despite the risk, the hard work, the hostility from society, the envy from neighbours, the state regulations, entrepreneurs just keep on creating, they keep on producing, and they keep on trading. Without them, nothing would be there." Whilst most entrepreneurs are simply driving for profit and return, I'm trying to do something rather different. I'm trying to enable something to successfully survive. I'm trying to create profit to invest in the future, and I'm not trying to drive value for a sale or anything like that. It's an unusual approach to a rather specific set of circumstances. Whilst the now, of course, is vitally important, because one has to survive in the short term and be profitable, it's not all about now, or indeed all about me. Most importantly, I'm trying to both look after something at the same time as build on it and create with it. And the whole focus is really about succession and passing it on in good shape, something which has been successfully achieved, amazingly, over the last 11 generations of my family, or in fact since 1672. As you know, my name is, my full name is Charles Henry Gordon-Lennox, the Earl of March and Kinrara, a bit of a mouthful. And I'm the heir to the Duke of Richmond of Gordon-Lennox and O'Bindy, also quite a mouthful. And it's the only English, Scottish and French dukedom. And there are 23 dukes in England. As I touched on just now, I'm the 11th generation of a family which has remained moderately intact since the 17th century, even though the family's financial fortunes gone up and down over the period. The land and property and the total extent of the Goodwood estate, which is where the family have lived since 1695, has remained amazingly intact. Goodwood is not that unusual in the sense that there's a big house full of beautiful 18th century stuff. We have a farm, quite a bit of forestry land and property. However, what's unusual about Goodwood is it's now quite a serious business, and this business has simply come out of the family's passions, the things that they've loved and done over centuries, and it's through those passions which we now try to share with the rest of the world that the business at Goodwood has developed into something quite different. A very English brand focused on delivering the most exciting luxury experiences, I hope in a creative and innovative way. We've no outside shareholders, thank heaven, so we can pretty much do what we like, and we do. It all began when Charles II, who was the King of England in the 17th century, fell in love with a beautiful French girl who had been sent over by Louis XIV, the King of France, to spy on the English court. She resisted him for years, eventually they had a baby, and the King made that boy the first Duke of Richmond in 1675. And he bought a house at Goodwood in 1697, and my family and I still live in that house. But as I mentioned, my father's now the 10th Duke, and I, hopefully, most 18th century aristocrats were mad about their sport. What was unusual at Goodwood is that they started to share their enthusiasm, these sporting passions, with other people. The first Duke bought the house originally so he could take part in the famous Charlton Hunt, which was the very first proper fox hunt in the world. As well as the various titles he'd been given, he was also given £2,000 per annum, and even more importantly, 12 pence or 1 shilling on every quarter of coal in Newcastle by sea. This was a considerable sum of money. Despite this, his son, the second Duke, was married off to cover a gambling debt of his father's, the tender age of 15, the girl was 30. They took an immediate dislike to one another, and the boy went off on a grand tour around Europe, something all well-educated young aristocrats did in the 18th century. His tutor, brilliant and well-connected, made sure that he met all the right people on his journey, and he famously brought Canaletto back to London, where he painted the now famous picture of Richmond House, the family's main residence, designed by Lord Burlington and on the banks of the Thames. On his way home from Europe, he stopped off at The Hague, where he met his best friend and they went to opera together. During the performance, he obviously wasn't listening much to the music, because he fell in madly in love with the girl in the box opposite. And during the interval, he asked her name and was told it was the Countess of March, his wife. They lived very happily ever after. In fact, she was pregnant 27 times. And they had several very well-known children. The eldest, Caroline, was the mother of Charles Fox, the future Prime Minister. Like his father before him, the second Duke was a very enthusiastic sportsman, important for good as it turns out, and shared his father's passion for cricket. The earliest known game was played with him in 1702, and we have the earliest existing written rules of the game in our archives dating back from 1727. The second Duke's death in 1750 meant his son was only 15 years old when he inherited. His son, the third Duke, was an extremely capable man. He was not only a general and a politician, also a lover of art and architecture. He extended the estate from 1100 to around 17,000 acres. Built extensively, enlarging the house with two new wings to display the art collection, which he'd been collecting since his grand tour around Europe. And as master of the Board of Ordnance, he was responsible for the mapping of the whole country, resulting in ordnance survey maps. He was also responsible for developing Goodwood's next sporting enterprise after cricket. He held the very first public horse race meeting on top of the Downs in 1802. Something that started as match races between the King and the Duke. They would have enormously extravagant bets on these races, and racing has continued at Goodwood, always in July, every year ever since. It has now become one of the biggest race meetings in the world, and Goodwood's the only privately owned Grade One race course in Britain. Nicknamed Glorious Goodwood by a journalist after the war, the name is stuck. And this year we have Qatar as a major sponsor for the whole week. Very much looking forward to having the Emir, Sheikh Joanne, and Sheikh Abdullah as our guests. Unfortunately, the third Duke was constantly in debt. In 1799, he crazily sold his coal tax dues back to the government for the enormous sum of £728,000, which gave him an equivalent income today of £600,000. It was no surprise, therefore, when he died in 1806, he completely outspent himself and was heavily in debt. In a funny way, it's taken the family all this time to recover in any way. As you might say in China, shows the lauter be mata. Okay, that was probably really bad, but translated it means a lean camel is bigger than a horse. The house was still largely unfinished. It was very fortunate that his great nephew, the fifth Duke of Richmond, inherited Gordon Castle in Scotland from his paternal uncle, the last Duke of Gordon. It was a huge estate, which at one time apparently covered at least a sixth of the entire country. And that inheritance filled up the family coffers again, and Goodwood House itself was finally completed. In 1883, before the agricultural depression, the estate brought in an annual income of about 20,000 a year, just about 1 million in today's money. This, combined with the income from the Scottish estates, provided the seventh Duke an annual income of about 4 million for expenditure, of course, and make it one of the wealthiest landowners in the country. However, like so many estate owners, they were financially very up and down. Some were financially astute, others weren't. And the improved fortunes didn't last very long at all. The seventh Duke heavily overspent and continued to live in the grand style throughout the early years of the 20th century. Heavy death duties were paid on his death, followed soon after by the 8th Duke's death in 1935, which meant that my grandfather was faced with some very big decisions on the future of both Goodwood and Gordon Castle. He faced death duties of about £6.5 million today and mortgages of nearly 10. Interestingly, his father had already created the Goodwood Estate Company in the 1930s and turned Goodwood into a company structure in which it's been ever since. My grandfather's great love was aeroplanes and motor cars, and he built both of them himself. He was a very successful racing driver before the war, winning spoken of Gordon races, much to the horror of his parents. It was from him, I'm afraid, that I got my love and fascination for cars. It was he who, in 1948, turned the perimeter track of a battle-ridden aerodrome built at Bouga during the war into the now famous Bouga Motor Circuit. When my grandparents moved out of Bouga before the Second World War, I don't think they ever thought they would move back, and in many ways they never did. Of course, this was the case for many families and houses all over the country. But I can remember well visiting it as a child, and the house was always completely shut up and covered in dust sheets. However, the world had changed, and these great houses were seen as something dusty and inappropriate, something from the past. Even those wealthy enough were often keen to hand them over as quickly as possible to the National Trust, or even knock them down, which sadly happened on a grand scale. They were seen to represent a way of life that was, it seemed, over and finished. Great houses were also seen as a bundle of trouble, and often still are, a massive drain on resources and energy. In Chinese, you might say, cha ta ye, which means big household, lots of work. There has certainly been a sea change in people's thinking and attitude over the last 25 years. And I've seen a huge change since I've lived at Google in the way people feel and react to these places. And once seen as an irrelevance and often a trigger for envy and anger, the mood is now much more open, relaxed. Positive. And by and large, I think people now feel the owner is by far the best person to be caretaker. They are certainly the most cost-effective. And in many ways, envy, I think, has changed to pity, because actually is very much why on earth would anyone want that responsibility. Different families, of course, handle that responsibility issue in very different ways. Some estates have always had huge external resources to prop them up. Some haven't. Some owners have gone outside their estates to generate much-needed income. Others have tried to do it from within. And that was indeed my parents' decision when they moved to Goodwood in 67, at which time I was about 12. In 69, they had absolutely no money, and the top rate of tax was at 98%. However, they were not daunted. It set about turning Goodwood into a business with real gusto. My father took some big risks and made some big decisions around sustainability. Somehow, we had to make enough money to reinvest in the infrastructure, keep the whole thing going. At this point, the estate was very much focused on the traditional business of forestry, property and farming. My father is an entrepreneur. He believes in risks. He also believes in minimising the odds against him. He's also a great optimist, an innovator, and thrives on change. And indeed, it's him actually over the last 20 years who's never once said to me, why on earth are we doing all this? What on earth do you think we're doing? He's always been the one who said right from the beginning, let's do it, try it, must be worth a go. And for someone taking over such a place, being a successor, if you like, that's hugely encouraging. If you're going to hand something on, you can't be all the time fiddling around with it. You've got to allow people to get on with it, make their own mistakes, and find their own way through. To have that positive energy behind you makes an absolute world of difference. The horse race course was my father's area of focus, and it was that which really began to transform the group in the 70s and 80s. This was the beginning of us really taking the sports. We'd taken the sports that existed there, and the very authentic activities we had, and turning them into a meaningful, hopefully modern business. Whilst the race course was developing much improved returns, it still wasn't nearly enough to sustain a relentless cash requirement. Other projects taken off proved rather more difficult. By the late 80s, business was still very tough. But Goodwin entered a new trajectory as a modern and well-managed company. It turned over about 8 million, employed 100 people, but the monster, worryingly, was as hungry as ever. A succession is an interesting thing and a vital one in terms of English history. Primogeniture, the passing on of everything to the eldest son, has enabled these great English houses and estates to keep going all these centuries without being broken up like they mostly have on the continent. It's a controversial and fascinating debate, but if succession goes wrong, all one's efforts are worthless, because the whole point of what one's doing is to keep something going for the next generation. One is simply a steward, one is taking care of it for the future, and that's a real responsibility. So for me, it's all about sustaining and maintaining and not selling. The goal is to simply hand it over in better shape than you found it. I've been involved in film photography from a very early age. I hated school, which I left at 16, which was pretty much unheard of at the time. And all I wanted to do was get involved in the visual world of photography, and most fortunately, I got a job working for the film director Stanley Kubrick on the film Barry Lyndon when I was just 17. And at that age, the experience of working with someone who never compromised, who always sought for perfection, and for whom only the very best would do, was life-changing for a 17-year-old, that's for sure. He was also a brilliant photographer himself, and photography became my career. Despite being a good one 25 years ago, it still plays a very, very big part in my life, and I've recently had exhibitions in New York, London, Moscow, and St. Petersburg. When I took over at the age of 40, succession being something we talked about a lot in the family, and it was agreed that I needed to take over at a very specific time and be young enough to actually take some real action. This is a big mistake that many families often make, not handing over soon enough, and when the income generation is still young enough to have some impact and to get things done. It was also obvious by the 90s that the business needed some fresh income from somewhere, and that we couldn't simply rely any longer on the traditional activities of the landed estate, and the race course on its own wasn't doing enough. I've always had a big passion for cars and for photography, and that's me on the left, both of which I shared with my grandfather. I absolutely loved coming down to the racetrack as a small child. It was a dream for me to meet all the drivers, be taken to the pits by him, and hear and smell those wonderful machines. This was motor racing's most glamorous era, after all, and Goodwood was its spiritual home. My father, thankfully, had the sense to leave the track alone and not build one or anything. So there it was, a perfectly preserved 1950s racetrack, untouched by the modern world. When I returned to Goodwood in the early 90s, I had a few meetings with the local authority about the possibility of reopening the track for racing. And it was soon obvious that this crazy idea was probably never going to happen, and they would be horrified by the whole thing. But rather than give it all up, I wondered if we could create something which celebrated people's motor racing heritage somewhere different on the estate, somewhere where they couldn't stop me, and where we could see if people still felt the connection. And so the Google Festival Speed was born. It began as a competitive event for a few friends with great colours, against the clock and in front of the house. We were told we'd be lucky we had 2,500 people. And to our complete astonishment, and to my horror, as I looked out my bathroom window that first morning, about 25,000 people talked. I couldn't believe my eyes. How many actually came we'll never know, as most of them got in for nothing. But we were completely overwhelmed and absolutely unprepared. We didn't have enough tickets. We didn't have anywhere to put the money. We were literally passing around old handbags around the car park so they could put the money into something. I remember lying on my back in the sun on that Sunday evening after the first event with all of my team completely exhausted and elated that we'd pulled it off. And at the same time, I was intoxicated by an idea that was running around my head that maybe after all the problems and challenges we would face, that maybe we'd perhaps stumble across something which could be our new golden aim. It required almost no capital investment at all that first year and cost no more than £100,000 to build and put on. It now costs nearly £10 million to build alone. 22 years later, we're still going strong. It turns over a considerable sum. We have a crowd of over 200,000 people. Bizarrely, it's become the biggest car culture event in the world, and is the only event in which all the Formula One teams take part outside of the Grand Prix, but also the only event to bring together all in one place all the various genres of motorsport from across the globe. It also, rather bizarrely and miraculously, becomes the biggest car collection in the world for 4 days each year. More great cars have been gathered together at Goodwood than anywhere else on the planet. And particularly odd for me too, when I remember how as a small boy I used to try and go to sleep dreaming of these fabulous machines. And now most of them visited me, and quite a few have even driven. I would never, in my wildest dreams, have imagined that might happen. The festival is also the only event where all the major car manufacturers participate all together outside of the global motor show. One very important factor, which is very relevant to great estates, which by their nature are often very conventional and conservative, is to do with change. Any entrepreneur must embrace change. One has to be happy to see things change. One has to find new ways of doing things. Goodwood has to move on and constantly evolve, and that is often particularly difficult in our world of families, heritage, and tradition. It was very exciting to open up this stage, as we did, and invite everyone in. Goodwood has always been very much about a shared experience. The house, for example, has been open to the public ever since it was built. And all the sports have been about the family sharing its interests, its passions. Our job, my job, is to try and deliver these passions brilliantly well and to share them with the rest of the world. And making these great estates like Goodwood relevant and meaningful in the 21st century is an absolute passion for me. As I've explained, all our sports were started by enthusiastic members of the family. over the last 300 years, and initially they were done simply for their own pleasure. Authenticity is a vital part for us in anything we do. It has to remain authentic to the place. It is now, for me, all about how we develop the brand, what Prud stands for, and how it's perceived around the world. We don't want to do things which aren't true to the place, and that's something we stick to in everything we do. We don't want to make a lot of stuff up either, which has no connection with the family, the place itself, which has no story to tell. Being an entrepreneur in the way I've described is about making the best of what you've got. It isn't always about starting new things. It's about doing things differently, looking at the assets that exist, driving them creatively and appropriately to deliver the best possible result. And that result is not necessarily all about profit at all. It's about a long-term game, having a long-term view. It's really all about succession and creating something of lasting value, something for future generations to benefit from and enjoy. And that was very much what I had in mind when we began negotiating to open the old racetrack. It took 7 years eventually to get permission from the local government to have a race again. Miraculously, in 1998, we had our very first Woodford revival. This is a full-on wheel-to-wheel motor racing on one of the world's fastest circuits. But the racing, which is as furious as you'll see anywhere, is merely the backdrop to what's become a massive, kind of vintage party. The revival, I think, is the only major sporting event in the world to take place with a completely period theme. Set in the post-war years of 48 to 66, which is when the track itself operated, the event attracts over 165,000 people. It's by far the biggest, most renowned historic race meeting in the world. As in the Pheasant School, we have a great group of partners who put so much into it and we are unbelievably supportive. Companies like UBS, Rolex, Credit Suisse, Shell, Tag Heuer, Vermeer, Burberry, and of course all the car companies, from Audi to Ferrari, Mercedes-Benz to Ford, Volkswagen to Porsche. We have over 150 such partnerships across the whole business, and they're a very, very important part of what we do. They generate a large sum of income, and we have a whole department of relationship managers looking after them. Developing and maintaining these relationships is something I spend a lot of time on. With the motor racing and horse racing now working together, I wondered if we could possibly get back the beautiful James Gray-designed golf course, which had been lost in the 1930s. It seemed to me that golf, which is apparently everyone's second sport, not mine, would perfectly complement these other activities, was also completely authentic to the place, as had been commissioned by the 7th Duke's children. That little girl was only 13 at the time. She asked James Gray to build her a golf course. This would also give us more year-round activity, which was vital and helped us become less summer-focused and reliant on a few major bursts of energy during the year. And whilst this whole idea began to take shape, it occurred to me that with the inclusion of golf, we could tell a better and more complete story. It would enable us to bring together, all in one place, horse racing, motor racing, golf, flying, shooting, and cricket. And this has kind of now become our mantra. With the Kennels, which was the original headquarters for the hunt, and considered at the time by far the most luxurious doghouse in the world, and where they installed central heating 100 years before they put it in the house, now also back in the fold and fully restored, we decided to create something called Goodwin Sporting Membership. This enables companies and individuals to have a very sort of bespoke group of activities and to access Goodwin throughout the year. They come, of course, to our major sporting events, the Festival Speed, the Revival, and the horse racing. They may well also have a box at the racecourse, their own track day on the motor circuit, their own day's partial professional shooting, a day's cricket on our iconic pitch, their own private golf day, a Spitfire flag pass, even a trip to Dover in one of our historic aeroplanes to go horse racing. Our members may well invite up to 800 of their customers to Goodwin each year. This has enabled us to increase our activity throughout the year and keep businesses such as our hotel, clubhouse, restaurant, bars busy all year round. It also means our sales team is focused on selling one big package rather than lots of small ones. This idea has enabled us to restore the Kennels and bring back to life a neglected but very beautiful and historic golf course. So if we can bring all these activities together, and all the plates, if you like, spinning at once, then the whole enterprise really does start to work. And the interweaving of these events, with all the other things going on at Google, is a really important part of us delivering the best possible result financially that we can. As part of the whole Google brand creation, I also wondered if we could tell a story about the place through its food. About 12 years ago, in recognition of my mother's interest in real food and proper farming, we turned our farm organic. with nearly 4,000 acres, which is a big organic farm, almost all the arable land we have is used to feed the livestock, which are all born at Goodwood, and which eat homegrown organic food all their lives. It's an absolutely unique closed system. We produce beef, lamb, pork, lovely milk, which turned out to be the choice of coffee connoisseurs across London, cream, three cheeses, lager and ale. It's a pretty small business actually, but one that has real potential. It also has it's also very long term and fits perfectly with what we're about. I really love the idea that if you come to Goodwood, you come to one of our events, part of that experience is to actually eat the place. Farming and forestry are vital parts of the estate. Looking after the land and the soil is at the very heart of what we do. And it's thanks to the event that we can now look after and maintain parts of the business, which are never ever going to be very profitable, which play a very important part in the feel of the place, the brand, and the story. It all needs to be kept together, because without all of it, the brand doesn't really flourish, and the whole place doesn't mean nearly so much. It is the complete story, the sum of all its parts, which is so powerful. There are always going to be parts of the estate, of course, which don't make very much money at all. But we have to carry on doing it, that's what we do, that's what the place is all about. And all of us are caught up in businesses. And all of us here are caught up in businesses that no ordinary businessman or entrepreneur ever in their life might get involved with. No entrepreneur would want to get involved with Google at all, but we really have to make a go of it. And I don't have the luxury either, like most entrepreneurs, of starting from scratch, or just ditching something that doesn't work, or walking away from something by then by looking at it, or not delivering an adequate return on investment. It's my responsibility as both custodian and entrepreneur to make it work, to have the ideas which will make it a flourishing and sustainable business. And that's not always that easy. We've also tried to find different innovative yet authentic ways to both drive brand and income. For example, 10 years ago, BMW, one of our biggest partners, were looking for a new home for Rolls Royce, which they'd recently acquired from Vickers, and asked if we were in any way interested in being part of it. They'd been a big part of the festival speed for quite a number of years. We pretty quickly, I'm pleased to say, found a suitable field. And it was a brilliant, interesting project. We first had to come up with the first site for BMW, but then we had to get planning permission from the local authority. But for the family, it was actually not an easy decision, because I really didn't want to do something that would in any way damage the place, or that we would regret in the future, or that my children might hate. Nicholas Grimshaw designed a fabulous building, which was sunk into an existing gravel pit, and which it curved its way out of, so becoming part of the landscape itself. Nick also covered it with the biggest natural growing roof in Europe. It's a completely sustainable building in terms of energy and emissions. It's also a great economic success story, as the brand was pretty much defunct as far as cars were concerned when BMW took it on. Rolls Royce are now producing over 4,000 cars a year, all of which are made at Goodwood, and they employ about 1,200 people. Indeed, Rolls Royce and Goodwood together are by far the biggest local employers. Over 750,000 people visited Goodwood last year, and we turned over more than 80 million, and we employ 650 people. We're now generating money to invest and thinking a lot about the future, although of course this is never enough, and there are still plenty of big challenges ahead. In many ways, actually, it all just seems to get bigger and bigger, and the monster worryingly still continuously needs feeding, so it doesn't really get much easier. Keeping something like Goodwood alive and well is a fairly relentless task, but a fascinating one. And hopefully we can continue to flourish, and through my children and children's children, continue to play a relevant part in the world by taking the best of being both modern and flexible, yet at the same time respectful and authentic to our history and heritage, and so remain true to our vision of inheritance and innovation, succession and sustainability.